the day that they're gonna throw it back to you. By now, you should have somehow realized what you gotta do. I don't believe that anybody feels the way I do about you now. Backbeat, the word is on the street that the fire in your heart is out. I'm sure you've heard it all before, but you never really had a doubt. I don't believe
that. So you see, not only different areas of the world, not only different conflicts of the world, but you see also different artistic, you could say, perspectives on reality. So this is much more artistic than the first picture. These kind of tents are really used in all parts of the world. And in a tent like this, maybe 15 people sleep, 10 people sleep, sometimes 20 people sleep. The weather, the wetness, the cold, and so on and so forth. Now we go upstairs. Very famous photographer, and also Henri Cartier-Bresson, which you probably know. That is, all, of course, very famous in France, since he's French. And these pictures also deal with the problem of exile and leaving home. Very high quality, because they are very close to reality. Yeah? And these pictures, on the other hand, they are not schnappschüsse. They are well thought out, they are composed, and there's, of course, a lot of intellectual work behind them. Shown you 5 minutes before the pictures of these little children. They are very moving. You see what the outcome of war really is, but at the same time, maybe you are so much concerned with the children that you lose a clear view on the structure of war. Small children, they want to play, of course. They want to enjoy their freedom. They cannot, because they are put into a situation that is almost like prison. Okay, just... And these... last series of pictures I want to show you by Leonard Fried are dealing again with a problem I have already covered. The question, what will you take with you when you have to leave your home? What is maybe most dearest to you, most important to you? You wake up late for school, man, you don't wanna go.
Peut-être là un moment ou l'autre, je vais parler en mots de français, mais c'est trop difficile pour moi. Excusez-moi. Ok, in English, I'm much safer in English. This is the place where I personally start the exhibition. The exhibition in the Wilhelm Hack Museum is called No Place Like Home. And as every exhibition in the photo festival, we have magnum photographers in our exhibition. And we will go to every station of the exhibition. Don't be afraid, you will see the colorful houses from the beginning. But I normally start here, because here I want to lose one or two words about what is magnum photography normally. And if you think about a cliché of magnum photography, what do you think about normally?
Black and white.
The best of all.
Black and white. But there's something special about magnum. And it's, you can very rapidly see what I mean if you look at the most famous founders of Magnum, which is Henri Cartier-Bresson and Robert Capa. Sorry?
Journalistic photography.
Yes, it's journalistic photography. What, when you think about Magnum photography, you think about very well shot photographies, but that come in the context of a reportage, of a photo reportage. And they made their own project in their own style. They didn't have to listen to any newspaper, editors. But they just went around the world to certain places and made photographs that told a story about what is going on in the world. I think it's Negro life in Chicago, something like this. And it tells the story of those people who live in kind of ghettos. And he's going there and tells his story that he went there and he at first was afraid that he would be attacked or something like this. But the people were very friendly, they were very open to him. And he says he thinks it's because they felt he just wanted to see humans. A photograph always needs a comment, verbal commentation, which helps you to put a photograph in a context of a narration of a story. And I want to point out this picture just because it fits so perfectly to what I said at this second. Have a look at this picture and tell me what you might see. And just give it a small title. Something you make up, completely free. In romantic painting, you often have those people who you see from the back and they look into a landscape. And you can imagine their imaginations. And this is quite a romantic motive, you could say, from what you see on the photograph. And now I can read out the title of the photograph, and then you see especially what I mean. Especially in reporting, a photograph always needs something that tells us what it shows exactly. And it says, a mother who has been left is thinking about how to get her newborn baby nourished in the future. The whole family is gathered, the way they present themselves is quite between representation and intimacy. And that's what makes those pictures normally bad taste, if you allow me to say that. If you, I don't know if some of you know these kind of pictures from your own life. Mostly when families come to professional photographers and make such portraits, the product is quite problematic if you look at it from an aesthetic point of view. Yes? No, normal houses, that's the point. What? Sorry? Gardens. And there is something very special in the way the motif is realized every time. You see a very, very special kind of composition in those pictures. What would you think is it? One of you said normal houses. What does it mean? Do you recognize these houses? Have you seen one of these houses in your life, in real life? What would you say, where are those pictures taken? Sorry? Over the city of Johannesburg, and it was the place to be for the white upper class in the times of the apartheid. There only lived the really, really upper class. And other people just moved in, but not officially, but they live in there, in this monster. And this is the inside, this is the inside court, and here there's the elevators. And these are the windows in the inside court, and you can see it's totally, it's like in a horror, it's a dystopic architectural landscape. In the same
context, we have another series by Jonas Bengtsson.
And he's visiting the slums in all the big cities in the world, and then he makes series that work in this narratic scheme. What do you see? First, second. What would you say is it?
Outside and inside.
Yes?
Yes, outside and inside.
Yes, outside and inside. He comes to the place where the people live, and you see these are the buildings. They're just like wooden boxes. And then he goes inside one of these living rooms, and this is the only room they have. And he always takes the family who lives in the room and photographs all the four walls of the room, and there you have the whole living interior of this family. They live exactly in this place and nowhere else. And this place is found here in the suburb region, and it's Jakarta. That are quite existential, that is birth and death. And the picture that is the secret center of this series is this one. You have a black floor with a few toys. And if you read the text that belongs to the series, you will learn that these toys are toys that the father of Christopher Anderson gave to him, and he gave them to Atlas. Now we come to another kind of private life of this Christmas Eve, but it's not as you would expect it, with a snow, white Christmas, and a Christmas carol, and whatever you eat. But the way it is documented is more or less not ironic, but more or less absurd. It's quite the language of the incarnation of the motif. It carries something absurd, carries something bad taste with it. You can see here the son is making love to his little doll. Here the father is puking. They are what is it called? If you have drunk too much,
headache.
Quite a headache. This is the food, but that does not look quite good. You have crackers, you have nuts, and a hand of an old woman, I guess, just grabs into the... it does not look very traditional. It's not from today, and they are from 1998. And they look like the 50s, the 40s, something like this. They have patina. They are photographed out of time. This is the first thing. But in themselves, you have a very, very dynamic time. If you look at all of these pictures, that's my impression of them. Maybe you can follow me. Every picture could be a film still. If you have a look at it, it looks like as if something's happening 1 second after it was shot. A way of shooting which is snapshot, but very bad snapshot normally. This one, that is not a good picture. If you look at it in a classical way of making pictures, it looks like a bad snapshot, and the motif puts something very, very uncanny into the picture, in every one of it. Also the pictures with quite erotic motifs, like this from his wife. It's uncanny to me to look at this. It's not quite a nice and easy erotic ambience that they transport, I think. You have the heart, but the shadow that comes on the face is not meant to make this picture quite quite happy in a way, although you have this heart. So this is again a position where a person documents his private life in an absurd way of photographical language. Drastic way of making a series out of the youth and childhood of your own two daughters. And these are the two ones, I don't know how old are they today, but and the point is, when you think about photographies of beloved persons, there's something strange at photographies of beloved persons, of persons you love, if you take pictures of them, and there is a quite famous theory of photography written by Roland Barthes, La Chambre Claire. And he tells us about what is special about certain photographies of beloved persons, and this is something very melancholy, because a photographic picture cuts out an instant of time out of flowing time. And because it does it, it keeps time standing still inside of the pictures. And if you have a picture of a beloved person, you can see the death of this point of time when the picture was taken. And this, he calls it the photographic death. He transports an idea of vanity itself.
Bye.